are more exciting additional programs for Edge of Galaxy Television as a brand new week, and I will bring you the latest happening in the exciting world of sports. And today on the show we are talking about a legend who gave not only to boxing but indeed sports and humanity as far as the world is concerned, none other than Muhammad Ali, who performed over the weekend at the age of 74. Indeed, the greatest of all when it's about sportsmen, living or dead. And then today we shall indeed be taking a look at the lifetime of Muhammad Ali. Portage. Also, we took Samson Yebue Siakia to talk to him at the Swan Invitational Tournament. This morning, again, we shall keep you updated as far as is concerned, not indeed forgetting the big one as far as the transfer window is concerned. Where is the next destination for Verdi? Let's sit in hoping to have talks with him as the transfer convince him to spend with one city, but the report says indeed that he's been equipped in the next couple of hours. He should be an Arsenal player. Well, this and many more we shall indeed be giving you on the program this afternoon. And now, I have my last strike partner in the studio, Okudua. Good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon to you, man.
Indeed, over the weekend, but a lot to talk about Muhammad Ali. Some see him as a sportsman, some see him as an activist, some see him as a prophet, indeed a man with so many chapters.
Yeah, a man with so many parts. He's all of these and more to many people. Muhammad Ali, can we ever stop talking about him? One of the names that changed the perception this century, if you ask me, and if I were to list 20 greatest men of this century, I will name Muhammad Ali. No one ever knew that someone could take sports to the level Muhammad Ali could. In fact, he made boxing something exciting. A fistic trade, a deadly fistic trade that left so many people, you know, impaired. And he made it nice to look at, and he made it glamorous on account of the fact that he had this baby face, pretty face they used to call him, the one who could dance like a butterfly and sting like a bee, the rope-a-dub master, the poetic, the man who could, you know, he was a philosopher, just about anything to many people. Ali imposing, where he stood head, shoulders taller than almost everyone in the so such an impactful friend, somebody who made you know, his own kind of by the way he packaged it, made it interesting, you know, on account of the way he presented it to fans. Boxing was not such a big sport before Muhammad Ali. Yes, there was a certain Rocky Marciano on the listing and a lot of others before him, but the time Ali took over heavyweight boxing, the whole started to identify with boxing. And I started to like boxing because of Muhammad Ali, because he would speak and he would do the talking and act the act on the ring. And so it was a man who talked and did what he meant. So a great man has passed on, no doubt, and the truth will keep falling in, no doubt. And we were not even artists, footballers, are giving something to Muhammad Ali at this time, because I saw him as a role model.
To Lennox Lewis, former WBC champion of the world, indeed a brave man, a character, who indeed stood for whatsoever he believed in.
But obviously, he gave the minority a voice and became the presence of possibilities. And he brought panache, theatrics, and precision in accuracy, and also the fact that This was a young man growing up at Kashmir and later became Muhammad Ali, born in Kentucky, lived life in Kentucky. He went through a whole lot of things and he was even introduced to boxing at the age of 12 by a policeman after he was battered by a neighbor. And he did a lot for boxing. He glamorized boxing. That's why when people know heavyweights now, they still don't attach to it because they see a lot of flabby men, journeymen who are in the heavyweight category now compared to a Muhammad Ali era where you see real men, you see some are bronze, some are brain, and that's when boxing was boxing. Not now that even the heavyweight does not command the type of followership or audience like the middleweight, featherweight, the likes of Manny Pacquiao and Mayweather. He was a revolutionary to the core. He had a very good speech. One of his speeches that I love was the fact that he said a wise man can play a fool, but a fool cannot play a wise man. And he said, tell wise men with vision are much more than a million army. And he said that the fight is not in the ring, or the fight in the ring is quite different from the one in Vietnam. That's why he had an issue, because he refused to fight in Vietnam and he was stripped of the title. But later a thing called judgment restored it back, and after that there was always the normal appellations before his fight. Thriller in Manila, Rumble in the Jungle, and also, you see, there was no end to all these serenade people with all that desire in boxing. Not like that, he got quick feet. Everything about Muhammad Ali was just like excellent. So, all the tribute, the eulogy and everything is well deserved.
Take a look at Muhammad Ali. Indeed, he says he is the greatest. Also, take a look at him in listing, and we shall take you back in time with visit to the country, Nigeria. It's the program Sport Edge, the station, Gaffey Television. And I'm taking a look at him. His back on the list in 1964, as far as the heavyweight category of boxing is concerned, the early 60s, and 2 years before Muhammad Ali came to Lagos.
Yeah, the fight against on the list was not given a chance at all. It was seen as a, you know, the lightweight to the heavyweight, you know, and do not forget he won the Olympic gold medal. He threw into the Ohio to protect the nation of blacks at the time. And that period of American history where there was more segregation, something close to apartheid later South Africa. And then he felt that blacks were maltreated, and as a way to show his disgust, he threw the medal. It was 1996 at the Atlanta 96 where he was given a medal. When he lighted a flame for the games. He was against on the listing. So the listing was a champion then. He was always bigger than in every way. And then at 22, nobody gave him a chance. Just 3 years short of later become the world champion much later at 19. At 22, he gave a shot, and the odds were stacked against him, but he shocked everyone, and that's how Muhammad Ali passed his coming into the heavyweight ranks by knocking out Sonny Liston, and he was to repeat it again, and Sonny Liston could never to have beaten Muhammad Ali at any time, and it was a fluke, but when they met again, he beat Sonny Liston, and since then, after coming to he returned. But if you fight, was stripped because he didn't want to go to Vietnam for the war, because he saw it as a senseless war anyway, and until the Supreme Court would matter judgment, in the sense that the first time the Supreme Court would in a matter of time about sports. And so he used the opportunity, because trust Muhammad Ali, he used the opportunity to rub it in faces of the white supremacists. He decided to change his name from Cassius Clay to Muhammad Ali, which he felt, was more akin to the black culture. And so, I even thought I was a Nigerian until I was told Muhammad Ali was an American black. And since then, he thought, and it was an thing he said, drew a lot of crowd, and at that time, the white supremacists didn't quite like it.
Take a look at the back involving Muhammad Ali and Saul Lister. Moment for Muhammad Ali, 1965, is back with Sonny Liston. Indeed, Sonny Liston at that point in time was the best pugilist in the world, and only Ali breaking down.
Ali brought psychology into boxing, because he will wait out before the fight and he tell you he's going to beat you, he's going to tell you all sorts of things, and he gets you just with his mouth first before the fight, and he reconceptualized the black people's because of his political stance, and so he's got a whole lot of scholarship, and like Sonny Liston was something else then. So Ali was never given an opportunity, but because he was a brave fighter, take punches and he could give, unlike the like of Tyson that could give what they can't take. So Ali, he go down in folklore.
So taking a look at Ali and then Sonny Liston's back, let's listen to the reaction of Ali at that back against Sonny Liston. Son of Muhammad Ali after victory against Sonny Liston. Right now, let's connect you straight to the Onikan Stadium here in the city of Lagos, the center of excellence. And for the records, indeed, Onikan Stadium used to be known as the King George Stadium. And when Muhammad Ali visited Nigeria, the president, he visited also the Onikan Stadium, to be again known as the King George Stadium. Show to dealing an African director group. Good afternoon to you all, live to the program Sport Edge on the television.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Football is concerned, and we take a look at the historical angle also of Muhammad Ali. He visited, and the one of the first in Nigeria, when he only considered, but just tell us what he considered as a speak. The director, indeed, a stellar group of managers, players like Gareth Bale, and for Africa, he's in charge of the continent Africa, and then they indeed in charge of players like Kelechi Nwankari. Officially, he should be an Arsenal player in the next couple of days. He came of age 2 years ago, and then we're expecting the Nigerian to put pen to paper. So indeed, that's one of the questions we shall be throwing to that were on the show. But then joining us today, I have Dabo Shotun. Dabo, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
Look at the special moment Muhammad Ali is lifetime.
Well, he was a great man, and according to what he said before, we all attest to the fact that he was a great testing of athlete, in this century. And for a very long time, he had been sitting down with Parkinson's disease, and that actually slowed him down. By and large, with the daughter talking about it, Laila, so he continued with father's stuff. She's a former world heavyweight champion in boxing and other things. Aside from Laila, all the other 8 children did not actually do anything about sport. They were physically in business. But if you look at it, he just lost the greatest athlete in the world. But he lived well, despite having Parkinson's disease. it did not allow that to, you know, to slow him down. He kept, you know, going around the world, watching boxing, watching some top class and sporting events, and he was relevant even up to, you know, the time he died.
Bringing the island involving George Foreman and indeed Muhammad Ali. One great moment, I'm sure you want to record it. Let's get Olubu back on the line. I hope the signal will be clear this time around. Some challenges, but let's get the reaction of Bill Clinton, President of the United States of America, of the demise of Muhammad Ali. You're watching the program Sports Edge, the Space on Galaxy Television. Apologies, but can bring you more reaction as far as the demise of Muhammad Ali is concerned. He died at the age of 74. Lennox Lewis and so many others have been paying tributes to Muhammad Ali. Apologies, let's take a look at the time of Muhammad Ali once again. One great battle that comes to mind has got to be against George Foreman.
Before the fight against George Foreman, he predicted that, you know, George Foreman was going to go down in the particular round, and, you know, he didn't go beyond that, you know. After the defeat of Foreman, you know, came back again, he was beaten again, and a lot of, you know, world class, you know, fights that he was engaged in. But the most striking thing about Muhammad Ali was his, you know, his possible quotes. A lot of it, like, you know, he float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. A lot of it now. One other particular one that people on the street, they talk about it when he says, you know, losing is nothing. You know, a lot of quotes. But the bottom line is, at the end of the day, he will be buried where he was born in Louisville on Friday, and there will be a lot of international leaders, top sports personalities, all, you know, crowding there in Louisville where he was born.
With the battle to you, Muhammad Ali against George Foreman. Apologies for the poor quality, but then we will indeed ensure that then we get it right. Some challenges right there in the studio. Well, let's take a look at the bouts from Ali, and then this is one bout that then the world keeps talking about, especially when you take a look at the history of heavyweights in boxing.
Yeah, at the time Muhammad Ali fought George Foreman. George Foreman was the champion at the time, and then Muhammad Ali coming back from a 3 year where he was stripped of the title because he refused to go to Vietnam, was discussed as a drug dodger. He had to fight his way back to reckoning, and by the time he came back, you know, the world had moved on, and George Foreman had beaten George Frazier. Joe Frazier to pick the title, and Frazier also had beaten Floyd Patterson, somebody that Ali had beaten earlier on. Someone had to be the champion, and it was George Foreman. It became a Herculean task for Muhammad Ali to try and strip George Foreman of the title. George Foreman, with his heavy punches, he had a higher reach, bigger, it was more like a boot. When you also notice that in 1971, when Joe Frazier fought Ali for the first time, it was a block counter, and that same Joe Frazier fell like a pack of cards to George Foreman. So it was a Herculean task, and what's his name, Don King, the promoter then, who decided to bring the fight to Kinshasa, then Zaire, which is now today Congo Democratic Republic, with Mobutu Sese Seko as the president then. The fight was highly talked about, there was so much hype, and promised George Foreman he would defeat him and take the title. After that, he had nothing to really place his back upon because he had no belt at the time. He was just a challenger coming into Africa to try to take the belt from George Foreman, who had awesome, you know, record. So it was everyone was excited, but Ali had the way of getting the crowd behind him, and you could hear the sound of Ali Bumaye, and he was able to, you know, electrify the crowd such a way that they him. And period, he also decided to introduce the style that is now known today as the rope style, where you sit back at the ropes, absorb all the punches, and try to wear out your opponent. Many likes of Sugar Ray Leonard and tried to adopt that method, where you want to take all the punches, wear out your opponent, and see how you can go. And exactly at around when George Foreman, because he had never stretched that long, no boxer had even stretched him.
I hope my prisoner will never that bad George Foreman.
Exactly. So, most in the first 4 rounds. So, Ali started, decided to stretch him, and by the time he saw that his legs became wobbly, and he went for the killer punch, and then down he went, and it was a famous victory for Foreman.
Ali in that fight, that was not the way he used to fight. Changed his style. He was more contained Foreman, and Foreman kind of tired. He was all wrong, but he didn't have Ali kind of brain. So Ali was kind of he changed style.
Ali after this bout against George Foreman. In case you've just tuned in, you're watching the program Sports Edge, the station, Galaxy Television, the reaction of Muhammad Ali, and then you could easily say Ali was also a poet.
He was a poet. Because looking at all his quotes, over 50 different kind of quotes, and they actually remained indelible in the world. Aside from, you know, you talking about sports, people are reusing it over time, and he's a fantastic, you know, he was a fantastic poet, and possibly that is why he also talked about, he also predicted the coming of a black president in America, and that actually came when Obama, you know, became president of America. And Obama himself, you know, just some days ago, immediately after the death of Ali, he said he was going to keep...
I'm sorry to cut you short, that we'll let them indeed take you live to Abuja, and then talk to one man who also had an encounter with Muhammad Ali. This time around, Ali Baba, to you all live to the program Sports on Galaxy Television.
Good afternoon, how are you?
I'm very
well,
Abuja.
Yes,
and everything is in order. I need to lost a great boxer, and then is a man of so many chapters. Muhammad Ali. How you remember and also want to describe Muhammad Ali?
Well, Muhammad Ali was one of the great boxers I ever put on the boxing gloves. Apart from being a great boxer, he was also a great human being, a great humanitarian. And they showed you, you know, how back in the 50s, you know, nothing else. But Muhammad Ali was a great man, very, very great. And he taught me, you know, for about 10 of days. I don't break myself because I am very weak into a taking Muhammad Ali. Personally, I never thought that he would die because I saw him like that die, and he was a god himself. And for him to die, then it's very wicked.
And share with us the moments you had with Muhammad Ali. What was it like?
Oh, okay. So we died, you know, with three. My friend, Muhammad Ali, that I won't let any of us from the train, and he will come instead of training the teachers, you know, it now has time to program, you know, the to keep it, you know, for the children. And then my dad is doing everybody in the area came around, and everybody was asking at the board of health. And I stood by the corner and I was trying to train training, and then I hope someday I'll be as big as this guy. But that was the point, you know, I'll never forget.
Very big thank you, Bash Ali, for talking to us live on the show from Abuja. Indeed, one great moment with Muhammad Ali. Amen. 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 That's Ali talking about Muhammad Ali, and then talking about the year 1982. He was on a gym training with Muhammad Ali, and he decided to go for a ride. And then Ali was about speeding. The police stopped him, and then instead of ensuring that he gets a ticket for his offense, it later turned out that then the policeman also wanted an autograph from Ali, and for the next 1 hour, Ali was signing autograph.
Ali was an infectious fellow, he was contagious, somebody you want to be with. Who wouldn't want to have a chat with Muhammad Ali? Who wouldn't want to be? I think it's one of it should be one of Bash Ali's highlights as a boxer to have met one of the greatest boxers, because if you look at
it, he's the greatest.
Yeah, you know, to meet Muhammad Ali was a great event on his own. So it's something he should, you know, really, I think he should write a book about that.
I want to ask a question now, Eli. It may sound ridiculous because it's ridiculous to me. If I ask, who is the president of the Nigeria Football Federation? What would you say outrightly?
Well, I could say Amaju Pinnick.
Okay. That what?
Two fractional presidents.
And
they are product of fundamental errors.
So there's no president,
there's no president.
It is understood that a lot happened over the weekend. The Football Federation went on their website nff.com and indeed released a statement which indeed said that Chris Gira brought talks to the secretariat of the Football Federation and broke the entrance dome, fought their way in. In other quarters, there were also media reports that indeed staff of the Football Federation stood their ground in order to ensure that Chris Gwam does not have his way into the secretariat of the Nigeria Football Federation. A lot happening even from the media and also from those who are administrators as far as Nigerian football is concerned. And the question is, who is the president of the Nigeria Football Federation? As we speak, report that Chris Gwam has taken over the secretariat of the Nigeria Football Federation. Did get across to Abuja and then hope that to confirm this and see what is happening as far as then the drama, the episode, and then I hope that the movie industry in Nigeria is also watching. It's so ridiculous, so laughable, that we can't find a lasting solution to the problem as far as Nigerian football is concerned.
Yeah, unfortunate, very unfortunate. Last week the House of Representatives Sports Committee met these two warring factions, the heads of these two warring factions, and they gave us an impression that all will soon be a thing of the past, but suddenly we are here now, just a few days after that. What it goes to show is some persons are hell-bent on doing things their own way, and to me that's a classic case of impunity, disrespect for the rule of law, disrespect for constituted authority, disrespect for Nigerians who follow football, and I think it's high time Nigerians, you know, when Nigerians, the so-called stakeholders we always hear about, it's time they begin to carry the placard and go out there. We want a solution to this crisis.
Well, talk about the rule of law, Henry. It's been said that there is a standing court order, that the Football Federation from Amaju Pinnick have also tried appealing. After first, Nigerians, that there was nothing of such on the ground. Last show this afternoon, I have Bear, Director of Communication Nigeria Football Federation, from the Chris Gira camp. Bear, I'd like to welcome to you all live to the program Sport Edge on Galaxy Television.
Good afternoon, Bear.
Confess that a lot of Nigerians are confused about the drama as far as Nigerian football is concerned. Reports on Friday has it that Ambassador Chris Giwa brought talks to the Secretariat of the Football Federation and forced his way into the Football Federation, but also learned that Chris Giwa has taken control as far as the Secretariat of the Football Federation is concerned. How is this bad?
It is a court order, and it waited for Ambassador Chris Giwa, a law-abiding Nigerian, like he did when he got to the secretariat. He waited for a writ of execution that was, you know, handed him. And on Friday, he went there and simply showed it to the resident security agencies, and they took him to the office, and effectively he's dead. The NFF, the other arm, unfortunately, because it's always like this, in the past 10 years, the other arm believes that they are there, they should also go there. Of course, like you rightly said in your intro, they have appealed the picture of the Ambassador Chris Giwa. So it's, for me, it's, there is nothing to even haggle over.
Then it's obvious that there are so many shady dealings, especially when we talk about interpretation of the rule of law, so to say, from the court concerning this. After all, the Football Federation came out under Melvin Amachapinic and said there was nothing of such on ground from the court saying that Chris Giwa should take over as Football Federation president. Only for us to also hear from the same Melvin Amaju on Friday when our reporter was on ground in Abuja to talk to him, and he said he gave reasons why they appealed. But from you, Nigerians would want to listen and then hear very well. You made mention of the necessary security agency with Chris Giwa to the Football Federation Secretariat. At this agency?
Yes, I think that the matter on ground here is very, very simple.
Okay.
There was a case before now that says elections in Warri that threw the president Amachapinic as president should not hold. And the election went on and it was held. So that in itself is a breach.
Okay.
So I'm not a lawyer though, I'm just a journalist like you.
Okay.
And then after that, there was supposed to be a meeting to realign and, you know, just certain issues that are at stake. Those meetings turned out very frustrated, they never really had an end. And then finally, when it was not having a head with the ambassador, you had a look, if it is not going to have a head, let me go to the court that actually gave me
everybody, and as I speak with you, I know that that's coming.
but I'm not sure the minister has received that report. We hear from some sources that the minister is trying to avoid receiving the report because, of course, we know Galadima cannot be pushed here and there because the report is going to be very frank and straightforward.
But
that areas that we should be looking at, then managing Nigerian football, everybody has an interest.
Okay.
In managing Nigerian football, for Ambassador Chris Gua, for instance, somebody who's been managing UFC, he's the chairman of the United Football Club, in case people don't know, he's been here, he's been there. His interest is in developing Nigerian football, not in destroying it.
Let's take a look at what is happening right now. Reports from the Football Federation in Abuja, especially on the Twitter as of last week, on Twitter on the last week Friday, that Chris Giwa brought talks to the Secretariat of the Football Federation. And you made mention of security agencies. Who were the security personnel that went with Ambassador Chris Giwa to the Secretariat? If I may ask, I understand that a report reaching me has it that then Chris Giwa is also planning to sue those involved in what you call fraud is concerned, that then the door to the entrance of the secretariat. This in any way?
I think I may not be aware, but okay. I think that I have advised that those who are Nigerian public to do that Ambassador Giwa is a very destructive person. He should, I believe so, and they don't think that you cannot every time it's something important personalities who have taken years, you know, to grow their reputation. I'm very happy if those concerned are sued.
Thank you, Ben Alaya, for your time, for talking to us live on the show this afternoon.
Thank you, Ian, for having me.
The situation as far as Nigerian football is concerned. Now you've listened to Ben Alaya, Director of Communications for the Chris Giwa Group. A lot happening. And Nigerians, this is the honest truth. It's about falsehood, a bit of truth, a bit of lie. Now one is saying this happened, the other is saying this did not happen in Lagos. And then if you have mouth and indeed nose in Abuja, we can indeed tell us the true situation of things.
The truth is, because of time, this story is getting messier and by the day, and it's unfortunate. What are the decisions the police is aiming Giwa to you know, ascend to the throne, so to speak, of the NFF presidency in spite of a committee headed by Galadima as well as the House of Representatives? I think they should have waited for due process to take its course, then we see how things go. But trying to take over the NFF presidency via court order, I think it's still very, very wrong as far as I'm concerned.
Do you think it's wrong?
No, it's
the
not.
More of the land?
It's not wrong,
but there's so much contradiction and falsehood, and now people are wondering which side is telling us the truth. But the law of the land supersedes every other thing.
Quickly, let's take a look at the results of matches played over the weekend as far as the Nigeria Professional Football League is concerned. Enyimba Football Club indeed lost to Nasarawa United. That was shot to Minu, who indeed is a fan of Ikorodu United. But then, Rangers didn't prosper over the weekend, and the coach is also happy. 3SC with Benga Ubote shooting, like they will say in Ibadan. Good result for Benga Ubote. What's happening to Ikorodu United? Down the goal.
Yeah, Earl was
definitely. But you can't stay there.
No, you can't. You can actually, but it's like the fans are getting impatient, and I don't want to blame them. The team is
stopping the Ubote from.
No. They are getting impatient. Okay. I don't want to blame them. If you are not winning, the fans will actually they will protest. And Earl was actually let loose yesterday. After the game, the fans started stoning the coach and even the players. And well, some two matches were there yesterday, talking about Amaju Kenny and his first wife, Sheyi Akinwumi, they were there. Akinwumi was actually on ground to step into the situation.
Is Pinnick running the Football Federation from Lagos?
No, I don't know, he was dressed in a tennis, you know, outfit yesterday, and he came there. Some people who were there were wondering why he should come to the stadium. They were said, it's free, he went down, it's free to come.
Not too much time to permit us on the show. We'll leave you with a clip of the great Muhammad Ali. So come around, see if we come your way again tomorrow. Me and Akira, bidding you goodbye.